What a park my kind of place could find. Parked it by the yellow line. What's thing gonna book you now? There ain't no place to park your car. I jumped in my car and say that we'll see.
I don't remember when I decided to be a cinematographer. It wasn't a specific point where I said, oh, this is what I want to do. I just studied filmmaking for several years, and one day I just decided that this was the route I wanted to take. And that was it. It started my journey. I'm from a small town in the States called Louisville, Kentucky, and it's a really small town. My grandparents were morticians, they were funeral home directors, and so I spent most of my life in that environment, in that world. And there weren't many artists in my family. There were a few artists in our community, but I always liked art, and I specifically liked pictures. So when I was young, I wasn't a big reader of books. I would always go to the middle of a book. Whenever I picked a book, it was always an autobiography. And if I picked the autobiography, I went to the middle section of the book because that's where all the pictures of the person in the book, the person who the book was written on, there was always a great sort of well-edited section of pictures in the middle of the book. And I think that was those are some of my first moments of being sort of image making conscious. But also, you know, when you grow up in a funeral home too, funeral homes are all about aesthetics. Funeral homes are all about design. It's about making people who come to mourn the life of their loved ones feel comfortable. So it's about creating a space that's, it's about creating a vibe in a space where we can change our association with death. And so, the funeral home that I grew up in was designed, and not designed, but decorated by my grandmother, who was very much into aesthetics. So I feel like I didn't know what a cinematographer was growing up, but I grew up around a lot of image intense environments.
This is to ensure fertility and prosperity.
Well, I feel like culture is the center of everything for me. My local culture my culture as a black man from America, my culture as a person from Louisville, Kentucky, is really important in the way I conceptualize images. I see it all as relevant in the way I at least specifically help create images. And so culture for me is the beginning. And you know, within culture, we have art, we have symbols, we have many things we can access in order to accelerate the way we see the world, accelerate the way we tell stories visually. And so, you know, my local culture is what I access when I'm helping develop images. And you know, I would always hope. A teacher of mine said that we should develop a piece of technology that can go into space and capture the voice of our ancestors. Because when people speak, or when people die, or when people sing, or when people play instruments, those sound waves don't just disappear, they go off into the ether. So he always saw filmmaking as an apparatus to go into the atmosphere, go into the ether, and pull those voices out of the stratosphere and bring them back to Earth. And so I always would hope cinematography would be a good tool for that. Cinematography, I'd always hope the cinematography would be an apparatus that could contain energy that makes you feel like you're at home, energy that makes you feel like a human being. You know, every culture has a way of imagining themselves. So whether it be cave drawings or whether it be hieroglyphics, you know, these are cultures' attempt to sort of create a series of images that tells the story of their existence. And so I would hope that cinematography is part of that continuum of creating images in order to tell the story of a people's history. That's a really, really difficult question. I'm not sure what it means to be a cinematographer. I think it's something for me that I'm still wrestling with. Because I think cinematography carries a lot of baggage with it. And so I'm still trying to unpack the baggage. I still haven't got to the core of what it is I'm trying to say with this art form. So I think it's hard for me to sort of define now in my career what it means to be a cinematographer. I know a cinematographer is an artist, and I know all artists have lived the artist life. And I think that most of us who are true and sincere to the art form are living the artist life, which is we eat, sleep, drink, and dream about images all the time. So, you know, that's the beginning of what a cinematographer does, I would think. In terms of what it means to be a cinematographer, I still think that's a work in progress for me. I'm not sure if I can answer that one.
I run a fair and clean business, and I will fight till my last breath to prove that.
These are dangerous times, and we have to adapt. It's not like when we was driving.
There were more murders and rapes in this city last year than there have ever been. So if you've come to tell me that we have an urgent security issue here, trust me, I'm aware.
This can't continue. You're at war here.
It's been 2 years since you started investigating my industry. Do you have any idea who's been doing this to us?
Or you may be doing something to bring this on yourself.
Well, again, you know, like I said before, film as an art form is laden with all types of economic issues. And when I say that, I mean that if you ain't got the money, you can't make a film. And when we were shooting on film, that was even more so, because laboratories had all the power. So you could acquire a roll of film. You could actually steal a roll of film. You could get a camera from a friend. You could shoot the roll of film. But as soon as you dropped it off to the lab, your negative was hostage. And you had to have money in order to free up your elements. You had to have money to free up your negative. You had to have money to free up your prints. And so, because, you know, I come from a country where we have serious economic disparities, and that some are living higher on the hog than others. In that sense, film as an actual material, I've always felt was always an elitist material, because it didn't include everybody. It wasn't accessible to everybody. You know, if you came from a particular cultural context or a particular community, you may not have had the capital nor the finances to acquire the roll of film and deal with all of the sort of processing and creating of elements. After you shot the negative of the film, you may not have had the money to do that. With digital now, you don't have that. You know, we removed a lot of steps from us, the artist, and them, the distributor. And now, more so than ever, it's us, the artist, and us, the distributor of the actual film. So, you know, film, as I said, film had the tendency to be racist. It had the tendency to be sexist. It had the tendency to be ethnocentric, because it wasn't accessible to everybody, where the whole digital thing sort of created a very interesting democracy where with just a few dollars we could all buy a camera and tell our stories, and we didn't have to deal with laboratories, and we didn't have to deal with, you know, the cost of one roll of film. And it was arduous, you know, when we were just shooting on film, because it wasn't accessible to everybody. But I think digital has made it accessible to everyone, and I think that's revolutionary. You know, that means there's going to be more stories. That means there are going to be more voices in the conversation, because you know, we can buy these cameras for very cheap, give it to young people to tell their story, and they do, and they can do it in quite proficient way. Film is one of those art forms where you cannot put your hand on it. You can't touch the screen and feel anything. You can't feel anything by putting your hand on the screen, but what you can feel is this invisible relationship between what we're seeing on the screen and the way our bodies respond to it. That is, that in a lot of ways makes us have to work extra hard to create atmosphere within film so that that feeling, that experience is really, really intense, because we don't have the sort of, we're not able to put our hands on our material. We create the material and it's projected on a one-dimensional surface, but we can't rub our hands across it. We can't actually put our hands on it. And so we have great responsibility, I think, to create atmosphere, to create vibe and create energy within the art form so that people, we can bring a more heightened experience, a more heightened sense of feeling to watching movies.
He's got supporters. Detroit, New York, Los Angeles, inciting large-scale arrests and sympathy marches.
I'm very aware of that, Mr. Hoover.
What I do know is he's nonviolent.
What I need to know right now, what's Martin Luther King about to do next?
Mr. President, Dr. King is here.
But all I can ever do is read a script and figure out where I am in the story. And once I figure out where I am in the story, it actually helps to inform how I can help bring atmosphere to the story. So, you know, my grandmother's house in Chicago, Illinois, used to have a particular sort of atmosphere, right? You walk in, you smell a particular smell. There was a particular sort of palpable energy in the room in terms of heat. She had a very hot house, you know? These are things you feel. These are energy. This is the vibe you can feel. And if I went into her house today, even though she wouldn't be there, if I went to somebody else's house, if I smell a similar smell from my grandmother's house, it actually transports me back to her house. And it doesn't even matter where I am. I could be in somebody's house in Spain and smell that smell and be instantly transported into my grandmother's house. And so, you know, I think all I can do is read the script and figure out where in the story is my grandmother's house. Where in that moment in the script can I actually bring some of the things I can remember within my subconscious to sort of the visual landscape. And I think the feeling one gets out of that sort of atmosphere is universal. I think the one photographer who's totally informed the way I see the world as an image maker is Roy De Caraba. Roy De Caraba he was doing things in his work that I would only hope I could do in my work. It's just sort of hard to explain what he brought to every image. There was just something so grounded about them, technically, and behind every story within the frame. His ability to connect to humanity at the perfect moment, at the perfect time, has been and it continues to be a big inspiration in my work. I mean, just if you pull up any Roy De Caraba image of John Coltrane or Elvin Jones, just the way he exists, just the way every frame exists in darkness, that perfect, perfect resonance in the shadow. It's just every film I'm trying to achieve that. Every film I'm trying to achieve that perfect resonance of life and energy in a shadow. And he does it. He did it so effortlessly, you know. He was a master at that. And so he's a big, big reference for me. I would say literally, I wouldn't even go any further than Roy De Caraba, because I just feel like from Roy De Caraba, other people come, but not like, he's like the tree of life for me. You know, he's my first point of departure. And then what I end up doing is I discover new photographers based on my free association with Roy De Caraba. It's funny, I'm sure Harris Avedis knew or Gordon Willis knew of Roy De Caraba's work, but if they didn't, I think they were subconsciously accessing some of the things that he was doing in his work. Those all three of those artists were in conversation in a very similar way in terms of how can you arrive at a moment in human existence, photograph the moment without much interruption from the artist or from the image maker. And that's what I love about Roy de Caraba's work. You know, that's what I love about Harris Saviti's work. That's what I love about Gordon Willis's work. Is I like the way these artists came to that moment in humanity and actually just arrived as an artist, not trying to implement a lot of technology into one's life, but just standing back, watching, waiting for the moment and capturing it as it is, you know? I would say a painter that who I'm now referencing a lot, just because, again, it's a similar relationship. The story within the shadows, the story about how one stands in relationship to this one-dimensional story, where stories are being told. I would say that somebody like Chris Ofili is another big reference for me now. It started with Mother of George, and from then I've just been so fascinated and so moved and so inspired by his work as a painter and the way he's able to make perspective part of the experience of experiencing a piece of his work. You know, you have to be at the right angle in order to see the detail in the painting that tells the story. And if you're off axis just a little bit, you're gonna miss the nuance. And yeah, he's become a big reference for me.
I think I shot someone.
It's gonna be okay. All you gotta do is wait for him.
I'm confused, Ruth. I don't know why you kids did what you did. What do you want to do now?
I'm gonna wait for him.
I said it a lot before, but like this is all I have. You know what I mean? This is plan A, plan B, plan C, and plan D. So if the cinematography thing doesn't go right, then I don't really have, you know, I don't have much to give. I don't have much to offer. You know, I think I could be a good father. I know I can be a good father and a good husband if I don't have a good partner, if I don't have cinematography. But it would be really difficult. You know, this is what I have. This is what keeps me sane. And so when it comes time to picking projects, I have to think about all of these things. I have to think about, I'm constantly thinking about my legacy. Not even my legacy. I'm constantly thinking about the residue I will leave behind as an artist. And it's not just the residue I leave behind as an artist as for viewers, people who don't know me, who come to see the work that I'm doing. But what's the residue I'm leaving behind for my son, you know? What's the residue I'm leaving behind for my children? What's the residue I'm leaving behind for the people that I love the most? You know, it's my dream that, I know that my loved ones are always proud no matter what I do, but I want them to be extra proud. You know, I want them to say that, you know, Brad made the right choices. He always chose well. And part of how I choose, you know, and again, I think that's relative. Not everybody's gonna think all the movies that I've chosen to photograph were the right ones, you know? But all I can say is that when I read a script, representation is a big thing for me. So when I read a script, I want to make sure that every character in the film is getting their due time to be themselves within the context of a movie. And so not a lot of scripts that I read are able to accomplish that. And you know, that's literally how I judge what I'm going to do and what I'm not going to do. You know, it's based on what is the film trying to say? Who's in the film? What is the director trying to do with these characters? I mean, listen, all these characters in the film have backstory, they have history, they have culture, they have parents, they have their own story to tell. And so, you know, it's my hope that all these films were and are trying to tell stories. Let's say one particular character's story is not at the expense of another character within the story. That everybody gets their moment to tell their story. So those are films that don't they're not a lot that come my way that have that good balance. And then it's also too, you know, what can I offer? I have my own taste. I have my own particular taste in the kind of cinematography that I want to pursue, and the kind of cinematography I want to achieve in every movie. And so, when I read a script, I'm always thinking about: will this film allow me to continue to nurture my own taste as a cinematographer? And again, that's not going to be every film. You know, that's only going to be a few. And you know, then again, when I say no to a film, that doesn't mean that the script is bad or the script was bad. It just means that it didn't speak to me in the sense of, can I create images? Can I actually help be in conversation and collaboration with other artists around the common goal of telling the story that has to be about images? And so, yeah, I choose carefully, man. I don't want, if we perish in this car right now, I would hope that my body of work speaks for itself, you know? And that they say, oh, he only made a few films, but every film he tried his hardest to, like, beat my personal best. Not beat anybody else. I'm not interested in it. I'm trying to beat my own personal best. Every film for me, hopefully I can grow up on every film, you know? I want to be an 80-year-old man shooting movies and say, I grew up on this movie. And if I can't do that, then I'm not interested, you know?
I know for homecoming that I want to go with Craig.
And who are you going to go with, Lee?
I'm not going.
What do you mean you're not going?
If she doesn't want to go, she doesn't have to go.
For some reason, Lee just doesn't like anything I pick out for her anymore.
You look beautiful, baby.
This isn't me.
There's this new women's club up there by the liquor store. You haven't heard anything about it, right?
The advice I would have to young cinematographers is that this is not a competition. Don't let anybody tell you that it's not a sport. we're not playing a sport. This is life. It's not a game, you know? And take every opportunity to do your best. And don't be distracted nor persuaded by somebody else's opinion of what is and what isn't. You know, you're the only person that can determine what is and what isn't, you know? And you're responsible for every frame you create. You know, and so you're the person that has to live and die by the frames that you generated. So I think the only way that we can feel comfortable about what we're doing is if we true to ourselves and true to who we are. And it's what Muhammad Ali used to say, is I'm not gonna be who you want me to be, I'm gonna be who I wanna be. And I think that's what a cinematographer's gotta say. I think every cinematographer gotta say that I'm willing to lose a career off this particular frame. I'm willing to, like, never work again because I believe that this frame is so important to create. This image is so important to create that if it takes food off my table, it's okay. Because this is the connection I believe we have to have to the art form. If we're just there to, like, shoot, make some money and go home, then whatever. I don't have nothing to tell you. You know what I mean? Because I don't know what that's like. For me, every image is the beginning and the end for me. And so that's why you always have to, if you really love what you're doing, you have to be prepared to give it all in spite of all the obstacles, you know?